declaring the end from the beginning. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. May the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Bear fruit to God, that your fruit should remain.
A heartful hello, everyone. My name is Suzanne, and we are Harmony at Home. We are believers of the way, followers of the truth, abiders in the word, and we find life abundant in our Master Jesus of Nazareth, Yahuwah Yahushua in Hebrew, which means God's salvation. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and the completeness of him is what brings harmony within us, peace that surpasses understanding. In this introductory video, we will take a look at the triunity of our nature, because this will set the foundation to the series of presentations that are coming up, which will basically be about principles of sanctification. And we parabolically refer to the story of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden to help us gain practical understanding of our spirit, soul, and body, and the need for a harmonious arrangement. So, are we really a three-part being? Let's take a look at a couple of scriptures, and we will delve deeper as we move on. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, Yahushua HaMashiach in Hebrew." So do you see how there is the holistic, detailed note of our makeup that's spoken of by Paul in this verse? Now let's go back to the creation story, and you'll see the same thing. Genesis 2:7, "And the Lord God formed man," so this man was formed of the dust of the ground, so that's a clue for body, for flesh, "and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life," that is the ruach, the spirit, "and man became a living being," soul. So as you can see, right off the Genesis creation story, we see that there is the three-part being that's introduced in the garden story. Now let's look further into the unknown. Jeremiah 1:5 says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you." So before birth, you somehow, beyond comprehension, you already existed. That's the spirit part of you. And the Most High knew you. In Hebrew, the word knew is yada. And it speaks to an intimate relationship that you once had with Heavenly Father. And I believe that this is the spirit man. And the spirit man knows this very well. It seems that we've all journeyed so far away from our Creator, unconsciously and consciously, so far and so long ago, we're talking in generational terms here, that our souls don't remember at all what that was like. So there seemed to be a disconnect here, but that's okay. You know, the scripture tells us that our soul's desire is to remember. Isaiah 26:8, the latter part of that verse says, "The desire of our soul is for your name and for the remembrance of you." So what is it that our soul has forgotten? And what would remembering feel like? Have you ever been asked a question and intuitively you know the answer? You know in your gut, but it hasn't quite reached the surface of your mind. It's stuck at the tip of your tongue. You see, the longer the delay in remembering, the more it becomes bothersome. So your mind secretly works hard at remembering all day long, only to see it come up by bedtime. And you quite happily blurt out the answer, and what a relief that was. So whatever the disconnect is, I believe, our spirit man knows it. But because our spirit is from the very breath of the Creator, this is why the spirit man knows it. And it just takes time for your soul to learn it. Your body is designed to simply respond to what your soul desires. Psalms 19:7 says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul." So there seemed to be this process of conversion, converting the soul to remembering. Just like the example that we talked about not too long ago, bringing to our soul's awareness what our spirit already knows, it brings a wonderful feeling of expression. And it really is a form of release. I like to use the illustration of breath, of breathing, inhaling and exhaling. When we inhale all that cool air, that oxygen goodness in just the right amount, for us to complete the circle of life, we have to exhale. And when we exhale, you feel the warmth of that air, that breath. And that is the evidential expression of life. You see, we are designed to express the breath of life that was breathed into us by the Creator. That is our spirit part. And the spirit part needs an earthen vessel to experience this realm. So that's the body, the flesh. And your very experience here on earth is your soul. Your soul manifesting through your body, moved by the Spirit of the Most High God. Do you see the connection? So you are an individual expression of the Creator Himself here on earth. So going back to 1 Thessalonians 5:23, consider the part of the verse that talks about preservation. There's a call for complete sanctification for our entire spirit, soul, and body. Notice the order: spirit, soul, and body. The Creator is a God of order. His original design is for your spirit to have rulership over your soul, and so your soul can direct your body. And we will see that play out in the garden story, which we will delve deeper in future presentations. But as mentioned earlier, we do like to refer to the Garden of Eden story in parables, because we will have a better appreciation of our triune nature by doing it in that manner. So what do I mean by parable approach? I will use the simple story of Adam and Eve to illustrate a moral and a spiritual lesson to help us understand the triunity of our nature, the three-part being, that spirit, soul, and body. Let's further break down spirit, soul, and body in simple terms. There is a part of you that is God conscious. That's your conscience. This is the part of you designed to worship the Creator. This is your intuition. This is your spirit, your inner man, the very breath of the Creator, the Ruach Himself deposited inside you. And then there's a part of you that is your soul, your mind, heart, emotion, intellect. This is your unique you. There is absolutely no one else like you. Every iota of experience, light particle that hit your eyes, every sound frequency that hit your eardrums, every scent inhaled, every taste, every sensation you feel is unlike anything else or anyone else's. And of course, there's that shell that houses your spirit, this flesh and blood. This is the medium in which our soul expresses in response to its experience, memory building, understanding, knowledge, etc. So why is 1 Thessalonians 5:23 calling for complete sanctification and preservation? And also, you see that in 2 Corinthians 5:18, it says, "Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to Himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation." So there's this ministry of reconciliation that has been given to us through our Messiah. Here is why we need to work for reconciliation or restoration to bring about harmony in our spirit, soul, and body. After the fall, you'll see the order of rulership become out of order. When sin entered the world because of the disobedience that took place in the garden, death came about through sin, and death spread to all men. We all know this, but we forget that for every input and output, there is a process in between. There's more than what meets the eyes. So this is where I want to park a little bit. So let me illustrate by getting you to think about food. When you put food in your mouth, the next thing we really see, we can behold with our eyes, is the elimination of the part of the food that the body does not need. We don't necessarily see the process in between, but we know because there's a plethora of scientific information that we've been taught, but there's a number of things that goes on in the digestion process that we don't necessarily see or even feel sometimes. So in the same sense, we look at Romans 5:12. We see that sin entered and then death came about. But there's a whole process in between that we need to pay attention to. The Creator designed us to be in harmony, for our spirit, soul, and body to be in harmony. But after the fall, what was in harmonious arrangement became in disharmony. So what was designed in harmony, spirit, soul, and body, has become disharmony, which means instead of spirit having dominion or rulership, that rulership has been lost. And now we see the flesh or the soul taking rulership. So this is out of order. As a result, chaos and war between our members is introduced and mixed into the process. And all of this thing causes weariness to the soul and body, which really ultimately is the reason for dying, for death. So it is in the flesh that we have an experience of death here on earth. Whether we see this or not, this is what's really going on behind the scene. So if flesh and blood dies, then what is the antidote or the reversal of death in the flesh? The answer is the gospel. And we know this. The gospel, the good news, good tidings, in Hebrew, that's Strong's H1319, it is basar. And do you know that it is also the same Hebrew word for flesh? So the Hebrew word for flesh is also basar. So I want you to see the connection. The gospel is where this journey must begin. Hebrews 2:14, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. So Jesus, Yahushua, came in the flesh to offer salvation by justification, so that through him we are delivered from this flesh of death. So now take a look at Romans 7:24 and 25 with fresh eyes. Because we need to comprehend what Paul is saying a little bit more. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. See, like I said, justification is the necessary first step to start the journey of sanctification. If we are not justified by the blood of the Messiah, then we are slaves of sin. We are serving the law of sin. And so the gospel, the message, the good news that our Savior has offered us is to free us from that, and so that we can start this journey of sanctification. So sanctification, in simple terms, is finding your way back to having harmony at your home. And when I say home, I mean this earthly tabernacle. And we know we have our spirit, soul, and body living in our earthly tabernacle. So the will of the Father, the God of peace, is to sanctify you completely so that you will be found blameless. You will be found in right standing in faith at the coming of our Master Jesus Christ, Yahushua HaMashiach, our coming King.